purpose of free speech is that through dialogue and through engagement and through reason, which again are these enlightenment values we've already discussed, through these means we are able to discern a way peacefully forward. Violence is the exact opposite of that. Violence is trying to impose on someone through physical force one perspective over another. And so it is diametrically opposed to free speech.
Welcome to The Shape of Dialogue. Today I'm joined by Jonathan Ayling from the Free Speech Union here in New Zealand. Welcome, Jonathan. Thanks for joining me on the podcast today.
It's a great pleasure to be here, Michael.
Yeah, yeah. Do you want to tell us what you do and what the Free Speech Union does?
Well, the Free Speech Union is an outfit. We are a registered union for employees, but we work beyond employment discourse as well. We're an outfit dedicated to defending and expanding the freedoms of speech, of expression, of conscience, and of inquiry here in New Zealand. And, you know, New Zealand historically has been one of the great liberal democracies. We're one of the longest standing liberal democracies in the world, as that category is counted. And so many would ask, well, is it really necessary for an outfit like that to exist within our context? And I wish they were right. I wish the historical reputation and the values that we had lived up to we're still true today. Unfortunately, it is absolutely necessary. In New Zealand, we have a frighteningly intense shift occurring at the moment. I would say even I've been in this role 3 years ago. I helped set up the union in its current form, and we brought on our first staff and such. Even in just the 3 years that I've been working in this space, an intensification of this opposition to the idea that individuals should be allowed to speak freely, to express opinions and perspectives that others find distasteful or offensive, or even, quote, whatever this means, harmful, you know. And so we have over 100,000 supporters. We are, as far as we can tell, the largest organization working in defense of civil liberties in New Zealand, both in terms of the budget we have and the staffing we have. We're entirely grassroots funded, but in terms of the support we have as well. And look, you know, I'm relatively young. I'm still in my 20s. Most of my staff are in their 20s. We have one permanent staff member who is in not in his 20s, and so we're a young group of people who are really quite concerned about the direction we're heading and the implications that will have over the next 10 or 20 years as our children start to engage in the wider world. And so there's a really personal motivation as well in terms of the stakes that are at play and what's on the line for us and our families if we don't maintain a value in our society that actually people should be able to think freely and express those thoughts.
Those are very strong words. You said, you know, I think you used the word frightening in terms of the direction free speech is going. Why? What's actually happening on the ground? What are the limitations to free speech that you guys are seeing?
The Free Speech Union works across four work streams, and I would say it is apparent in each of those, but especially the last, which I'll come to, that really justifies the use of the word frightening. For me, Michael, and you and I have discussed this a little bit, words really matter to me. I love language. I love the way people dialogue and they express themselves. I've studied six languages, and I just think it's fascinating to look at the way different individuals and different cultures and languages, obviously, have sought to communicate within a society. And so that's really where my interest comes from. And so I try not use words frivolously, and I don't use that word frightening frivolously. We work across cases, campaigns, content, and coaching. I have a thing for alliteration, so it had to fit in the categories of C. And so in our cases, we provide legal defense. And I think today we're going to talk about one of the cases that we've brought on. But at the moment, we have about half a dozen cases before the courts and a number of additional cases that we're working on more peripherally. We have taken cases to the Supreme Court here in New Zealand and really advocate as per the law that is currently in place in New Zealand under the Bill of Rights Act 1990 and the Human Rights Act 1993, principally are what constitute our legal right to free expression in New Zealand. So I'm not a lawyer. I'm surrounded by many lawyers. And I thank God for the good work that lawyers do with us and for us. I would suggest to win, if we can reduce it to such a simple concept, to win the fight for free speech in New Zealand. We're not going to do that just through legal means. We need more than law, but it's a crucial component of our work, of course. We also have We also have campaigns. Campaigns relate more to my background. I worked as a political staffer for a number of years. I've worked in Wellington, now our capital, where the NGOs are based. I've worked for a number of NGOs there as well. And I worked in the Beehive, our centre of government, and in opposition as well in our parliamentary system. And I believe that access to our political representations, beyond the laws that they make, just the representative function that they have and the impact that has on our culture and society is really crucial as well. So, for example, two of the three largest public consultations that have ever been run in New Zealand have been majorly impacted by the Free Speech Union. The first was hate speech laws, which were proposed under the previous government. That was the largest public consultation at the time. Almost 20,000 submissions were made then, and this is 3 years ago now. I think we submitted about 16,000, or facilitated the submission of about 16,000 of them, and we're without a doubt the leaders in the space that led ultimately to the hate speech laws being cancelled. Another would be a campaign that we ran last year on what was called safer online content. Effectively, it was hate speech laws for the internet, kind of a take two. This time we facilitated over 90% of the submissions. We facilitated over 18,000 of the almost, or slightly over 20,000 submissions. So we have a relatively large base to draw from in terms of facilitating political engagement and public pushback. We also do content, and so of course it's without a doubt not as sophisticated as the shape of dialogue, Michael. But our podcast reaches a few people as well, and we speak around similar issues that you do, around open dialogue and the importance of this in a variety of spaces. We'll write op-eds, and on our database we have 100,000 people that receive our emails. So every couple of days we put something out that has relatively strong engagement. We've produced documentary films, we host events around the country, we do tours and that sort of thing. So that's the content form, which is really the culture creation, trying to draw an engagement from a wider public who may not be familiar with our legal work, who may not really care about what's happening in Parliament. But they'll come along and hear a speaker. They'll pay attention to some billboards that we put up or something like that. And the final one, and Michael, this is the one that is the less dramatic. It's the less sexy, if I can put it that way. But I think it's really the most important, and it's what we call coaching. And we call it that because it's bigger than education, but we also call it that because it had to have a C. And so it really amounts at the moment to us engaging in high schools. We go in and we speak in assemblies, and we speak in history classes or English classes around critical thinking and free speech and how that works. We engage in universities. Just this week we hosted the finals of a mooting competition, for example, where we take law students and present a free speech case to them and make them argue around that. At the moment, we are the named sponsors of the New Zealand Secondary Debating Society, so the National Debating Society in high schools that will come together at the end of this month in Parliament. So really, as far as I can tell, there is enormous disconnect between generations on this issue. Where if you are, and I'm somewhat arbitrarily picking numbers here, but if you are above roughly 60, free speech is a given to you, and really regardless of your political inclinations, you think it is crucially important that individuals should be able to express themselves freely and let you engage with that. For those kind of more maybe 35 or 40 up to 60, there's a little bit more apprehension around that, but for the most place they're inclined towards letting people speak rather than taking too firm a stance around shutting down particular opinions. But if you're under 30, and I would say this in New Zealand, but I travel quite extensively overseas as well, and I'd say from my experience in Canada and the US and the UK and Australia, I think if you're under 30 and you're university educated, you probably have very little space for free speech in your life. You probably have very little respect for the function it produces. And if you're not from university, you may have a little bit more respect or value for it, but equally still, there are many categories of speech that you think absolutely should be prohibited or censored. And that is terrifying to me. If I can use, I used the word frightening earlier, I would say it still makes me very afraid for our society, for the Anglophonic West. What happens to our society as we start to feel justified in suppressing and effectively deleting certain forms of thought and certain forms of speech? I grew up in Mozambique. My parents were humanitarian workers there, and we moved there in the late 90s. And I would say that experience, along with wider kind of contributing factors, but that experience certainly played quite a remarkable influence in terms of me seeing the impact of alternative political perspectives and alternative value structures. Mozambique had been devastated for almost 30 years by an incredibly destructive civil war, where it was the front line of the Cold War in many ways. Mozambique was what was called a second world country. It was a Soviet satellite state. And so the impact of communism and Marxist thought and a disregard for the civil liberties and values that you would expect within a democracy, even outside of a liberal Western democracy, just a democracy in general, it certainly confirmed for me that there are far worse ways for us to structure our society than allowing people to say things that are problematic or distasteful. So that's I'm sorry, I've entirely forgot what your original question was. I think you may have asked me why I found it frightening. I'm trying to illustrate across those four extremes.
That was a beautiful answer, but give us some examples. You know, maybe two or three specific examples that have come across your desk. Sort of the most egregious ones, I suppose.
Well, let me do a few that this week we're dealing on. Because they're fresh to my mind. Yeah. At the moment, we've got a case where we're suing the Attorney General on behalf of the police for abusing the protest rights of a woman that we're defending who was participating in a... there was a pro-Palestinian protest passing her by, and she disagreed with some of the opinions she saw being expressed there, and so took a piece of paper and wrote on it a selective condemnation of genocide as evil. And what she was saying is, effectively, if you're going to call this genocide, there's quite a few other conflicts around the world that you're not calling genocide. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. And police came up to her as she was silently standing to the side of this protest and said that she had to move. She's a barrister and so knew her rights relatively well, and as many barristers are admirably stubborn type. And she said, no, I can absolutely stand here and hold my sign silently. I'm not bothering anyone and they don't need to bother me. And ultimately, she was arrested, her sign was destroyed, and she was held for an hour and then released only on the condition that she would not return to the scene. So it's a fundamental disregard for the right to counter-speak, for the right to counter-protest. The free speech position asserts that there are, of course, bad ideas out there. I mean, depending on how you want to label this...
Well, most ideas are bad. That's the harsh reality.
Many of them are harmful, depending on how you want to characterize that. I can certainly imagine ways where I would agree with the characterization that ideas can be harmful. But that's not a particularly interesting observation. I think we can all agree with that. The far more interesting question is, what do you do about that?
Well, just going back, you used the word bad. You said, ideas are bad. And there's a difference between bad and harmful.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely, there are. There's a difference between those two, but I would suggest that some ideas are harmful. I think some people go, I don't think some ideas are violent, but I think we push the boat out too far if we say, and they're not even harmful. Of course ideas can be harmful. You know, the Catholic Church was thoroughly harmed by the free ability for victims of abuse from within the Catholic Church to speak out on that. You know, ideas and the forms of speech can, of course, do harm to institutions, harm to forms of belief, and even harm to individuals, I would say. But putting that aside as a given to an extent, I would say the far more interesting question is, okay, well, what do we do with, quote, bad ideas, or what do we do with, quote, harmful ideas? And I would say that opposed to censoring them or trying to control them or suppress them, the most effective means that we have at our disposal, not an imperfect one, but the best we have, is to allow them to be expressed so that they can be counted. And so that's why we have stood by the right for, simply put, for idiots to say idiotic things, simply because I would rather know who the idiot in our society is. Not because I have much time for their opinions, but because at least then I know who has those silly opinions and I can counter them. And that's why, Michael, I would suggest that a belief in free speech is founded necessarily on a belief that we can discern, that reason is a path forward, that there is a truth, maybe not on every issue, maybe not a comprehensive truth, but some form of objective truth that we can seek. And many of the cases that we take on come from people who insist, well, that's not my truth. And I would suggest this very postmodern, whether, you know, it's the Foucault or the Butlers or the Crenshaws of the world, this postmodern opposition to truth is at the heart of so much of the work that we have to do. So that's one example. We're now suing the Attorney General. Another example is, free speech in universities is an issue around the West, particularly the Anglophonic West. Just looks at what's happening in the United States right now. And the Vice Chancellor of Victoria University and I, Victoria University is one of the large public universities here, one of my alma maters, and the Vice Chancellor of Victoria University wrote an op-ed opposing the government's policy to put in financial sanctions for universities who fail to defend the speech rights of academics. And I think he's wrong on this, and I think
what's his name?
His name is Nick Smith.
Then it is Nick Smith. Yeah.
Yep. Okay. So the Vice Chancellor of Victoria is Nick Smith. He wrote an op-ed.
He was the previously National Party.
Nick Smith. There are two Nick Smiths.
Yeah. Okay. Good.
One with a K, and one without a K.
Okay.
So I penned a counter op-ed that the Post, our capital's newspaper, was good enough to run, and I disagreed with him. And to his credit, he said, "Well, this is really interesting. We've got some difference here. Let's have a panel. Let's have a discussion about university and free speech." And this kind of turned into a quite an anticipated event. There were about 600 people who wanted to be there in the live audience, and it was hotly anticipated for the end of April, but my presence there was so scandalous that students provocated and threatened to boycott and protest because I would cause, quote, harm to the students because I have stood up for, the Free Speech Union has stood up for the speech rights of outfits and individuals that they disagree with.
Can I just ask you a question on that? Were they specific on what harm meant?
Of course not. No. And I don't even know if they know what that means. But it's a good thing to say nowadays if you want to shut someone down. So they claim some sort of vague harm, and it probably in their mind would only compound the harm if you asked them to explain what that harm was. So don't do that. All that to say that the panel was then delayed, and identitarian politics prevailed. And now, really in reality, while the panel discussion has been reset, it's a panel discussion about identity politics more than it is about free speech. You've got
Can
a host
you just
of
explain what identity politics is?
Identity politics is this, again, and I don't want to give anyone kind of bingo cards to tick the boxes of cliches, but it's a cultural Marxist perspective that's come out of this postmodern view that places values not on the animating factors of individuals, not on that individuals have agency within society, which is this very enlightenment driven perspective that has, in my opinion, led to the most peaceful, prosperous, and freest societies in the world.
Yeah, but a humanistic perspective.
That's right. But it's a return to this this far more tribal, collectivist view that an individual is not defined primarily as an individual, but they're defined by certain characteristics that are selected. Well, I'm not sure who selects them, really, but
immutable traits. Such as skin tone.
Well, and that's what they are now. So today, that's why I'm saying I'm not sure really who picks these traits, because in the past, it was something more like a religious association. Michael, what it is. It's what society invests its power in. So in the past, religious authorities, and for example, the church in Europe, was the vested entity with the greatest power. And so that became the social currency at play. Nowadays, it's not a religious affiliation, but it's a sexuality, it's gender, and race primarily. And so the Free Speech Union has conducted a number of research projects on academic freedom in New Zealand. We asked them, academics, whether there were certain subjects that they felt very afraid to speak out on. One of the definitions and legislation in New Zealand of academic freedom is that academics are able to voice provocative or unpopular perspectives. And I'm sorry, I'm trying to remember now. I think it was 43% of academics said that they felt unfree to express unpopular or controversial perspectives. I'm not really sure what the purpose of the university is if it's not a space anymore where individuals can say remarkably stupid things and be told that they are remarkably stupid. Michael, I would have had a much less interesting career at university as a student if I had been unable to express silly ideas and then ultimately wear the consequences, and I use that word intentionally, not the retributive consequences, but the intellectual consequences of expressing silly ideas. It's not that I was excluded from the university for those ideas, but I had to own the fact that I had said something stupid and that there was a reasoned, dialogical, intelligent way to deconstruct the ideas that I had put forward. And really, that is the very purpose of the university. And if it's not anymore, what we have are base camps for indoctrination, not education. And so I would say if it's not a wake-up call that our universities can no longer abide the presence of free speech advocates in their midst anymore, I'm not sure what is. There's a number of other cases, Michael, that we'll continue to talk about publicly in the coming week. But I've never been more convinced than I am today, even just as I've come out of some meetings, that we are at a watershed point. You know, we're at a moment in history where it is very possible, I think. I'm too young to have given up hope. It's very possible that we can course correct on this. And I think there are examples in other countries.
Sorry, did you say very very possible or
very
impossible?
It is very possible that we can course correct.
Yeah.
It is certainly not a given, though. And I would say that while societies take a long time to build values that that invest in a society and create prosperity and peace, these are often values that do not take long to deconstruct. And I would say we're already some way into this, and within one or two generations, you can see incredible regression occur. And I'm worried that unless, and when I say within the short period of time, I'm talking about the next 5 years. Mm. I would suggest that that's the time period really that we have to deal with this.
If you look back at history, things can change very quickly. Germany was the most enlightened country before the Nazis came into power. It had all the top universities, all the great scientists, all the great musicians, all the great composers were all German, essentially. And then things changed very dramatically, and it was completely destroyed in just a decade or so. I'm not saying that will happen here,
Certainly, but
I'm just pointing out that things
not
can
on
change.
Our watch, right,
not
Michael?
On our watch, definitely not. So, just before I ask the next question, which is about the political orientation of the Free Speech Union, just want to throw in a little anecdote. I was at a talk recently at the Royal Society of New Zealand, and after the talk, this woman said to me, "Oh, you know, are you Michael Goldwater? You know, Shape of Dialogue podcast. I'm a fan. Blah blah blah," and that was nice. And she went on to say, "Thank you so much for the work you're doing." And I'm just saying, "Well, I'm just having some conversations." And she said, "Yes, but you know, we can't say what you're saying, and it's not like I'm saying anything radical. I mean, it's all I'm doing is saying,
on the contrary, nothing
very
is
centralist."
More nothing is more radical than the truth, Michael.
That is true. Well, yeah. But I'm just having conversations with smart people. But it was just fascinating because I said, "Well, why didn't you say it?" And she said, "We can't." And she said, you know, none of her colleagues can say what they actually want to say.
And Michael, I would suggest this sounds like an individual probably employed at our universities, quite possibly at Victoria University.
I couldn't possibly comment.
No, and yet these are the exact comments and the exact stories that we hear every day from academics around the country. Yeah. And that is why, just a moment for a little plug from the FSU, if you don't mind.
Yeah,
we've just launched our first profession-specific membership for the FSU. And this is one of 8 profession-specific memberships that we're going to be launching over the coming months before the end of the year. And for academics, that's absolutely where we need to start. You know, Michael, often people will ask me, where did we go wrong on this? What caused the shift that has occurred over the past... I would suggest it's probably over the past 40 years that this has really been afoot. Where did it all go wrong? And a lot of people say the media is to blame for the shifts that have occurred in our society. Some, and I would say this is relatively uninsightful, but some would suggest it's come from political leaders, whereas I don't think that's true at all. I would suggest that ground zero for this is the university.
Well, I was going to say, who trains the journalists?
And that is the really fundamental question. Of course, media is a great culture creating institution, but up until and as far as I can tell, about 30 or 40 years ago, many journalists, most journalists I understand, received no tertiary education. It was on the job training. Yeah, it was an apprenticeship.
It was a trade skill, essentially.
Exactly. Mm. And so you rocked up and you found someone who'd been there for 30 years who you thought you could work under, and they probably bollocked you a little bit and you learnt the trade. Whereas now journalists go and study communications and journalism and probably philosophy and art history alongside it, and receive an entire education or indoctrination on how to think about these issues, not how to think generally. Mm. And so then once they've gone out, I understand that then this has an enormous impact on the way that they will then engage with ideas that don't align with what they received there. Michael, I apologize, this is somewhat disconnected from the subject we're going to pursue. But what's of interest is in 2022, the World of Journalism study was released. And this is one of the most comprehensive reviews of journalism in the world. It takes place in many, many countries around the world. And in New Zealand, the data for New Zealand, they spoke to a quarter of the New Zealand journalist population. So it's an incredibly robust sample. And they asked journalists to rank the most important functions that they perform in society. And as you would expect or hope, the first function that journalists perceive that they have is to report information. And unfortunately, that had dropped since in terms of how high it was ranked. It had dropped in comparison to the previous survey, but that was still number one. But number two, and just behind it, I'm trying to remember now, I think it was less than 0.1% difference. It was 0.1 point difference.
Within the margin of error.
It was very, very close. The second one was to counter incorrect information. And what was really striking about that ranking was that motivation hadn't even featured as one of the motivations 5 years earlier during the previous survey. And then all of a sudden, over 5 years, and look at what's happened over those 5 years. I'm not surprised now. Given the political and cultural and social shifts that have occurred, even just in that short period of time, over that period of time, this motivation in journalists has arisen to counter misinformation or counter disinformation.
Now, what's wrong with that? Surely we don't want misinformation and disinformation.
Well, I agree. The problem is journalists appointing themselves as the authorities on what mis or disinformation is. And so, I there are respectable people who I know who think these are appropriate terms to use. I disagree. I think the terms mis and disinformation are categories in and of themselves that are inappropriate for meaningful conversation in this space. If you look at the origins of the terms mis and disinformation, they came out, I believe it was in the 1920s, in Bolshevik Russia. And they came out in the context of a communist party state intent on describing what sort of information was appropriate and what sort of information was inappropriate. Now, I think your point there, Michael, is a very correct and credible one. That, again, of course, there is all sorts of information out there that is incorrect and counterproductive and destructive and possibly, again, that word emerges, harmful. The way we explore that and decide that is through the deliberative dialogical function of individuals getting to decide that. And I would suggest that journalists now have appointed themselves information specialists in chief, and often this doesn't relate to any sort of actually empirical objective knowledge that we have, which of course does matter. And so, you know, there is objective empirical knowledge that we can have around aspects of science, and that might relate to, you know, aspects of climate change or access around aspects around vaccines, for example. There is something to be said for stating empirical knowledge in that regard. There's also all sorts of knowledge where, of course, we claim to be correct and we can make that argument, but there isn't a conclusive evidence for us to prove that. And at that point, the far, quote, safer way for us to go forward is not to invite censors in to suppress potentially incorrect speech. It is to allow individuals to explore that themselves. And I have this belief that societies as a whole, not individuals, but society as a whole, are the agents, are the groups that are best trusted to come to these conclusions. And that's why I believe in democracy. Now, of course, there are all sorts of examples of societies that have chosen the wrong things or have believed the wrong things as a whole. And unfortunately, that's just unavoidable. That's part of the reality, is that not only can individuals be incorrect, but entire groups can be as well. But it's, if entire groups are incorrect, it's almost certain that any one of the individuals that we would have chosen instead to be representative for us would have been incorrect as well. And so while it is not foolproof, I think it's the best option we have.
Yeah, well, the opportunity that freedom of speech gives us is it gives us an opportunity to course correct. I mean, if you look back in history, many individuals and many societies have chosen sort of suboptimal opinions and ideas and ways of doing things. And freedom of speech allows for the little boy to say the emperor has no clothes. Mm. And then that can be then extrapolated throughout the society. Totalitarian societies, authoritarian societies, don't have that ability.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a, maybe another way of putting it, without that ability, one tends towards the authoritarian side of this political spectrum.
Without a doubt. And in terms of the political inclinations of the Free Speech Union, I can genuinely say that both the left and the right have used and abused free speech. The Free Speech Union itself has no interest in one particular political perspective or another. Within our team, we have considerable political differences, and certainly, and even more so at our council level, diametrically opposed perspectives. I gave up some time ago expecting my council to agree on anything, not even where to go to lunch, except that individuals within society should be free to speak openly and to think openly and allow society to respond to their ideas and their speech through that. And so, you know, I would suggest that while we are not in any way defined by our association with the left or the right, we are absolutely defined by our anti-authoritarian perspective. And I think to defend free speech, that is incumbent, that censorship, whether it comes from the left or the right, and nowadays we see censorship coming more from the progressive left, it is necessarily an authoritarian enterprise. It is trying to impose, and often impose violently, suppression and control over individuals and dissidents and those who would speak against orthodoxies. And so if there's anything within me personally that to describe my political outlook, or certainly the outlook of the Free Speech Union, it is that we do not believe that authorities should be vested with power to suppress or control individuals' thoughts or speech.
There are limits to freedom of speech, though, aren't there?
Absolutely.
You know, one way I actually frame it, there's no such thing as free speech, because free speech would mean that you can say anything. But there are limits to what we can say, legal limits to what we can say.
Well, yes. And this turns into the sort of discussion that can have many legs, Michael. I would suggest that free speech should be considered as a proper noun. It is a perspective and a position that has a purpose, that can be clarified and defined. And so I always say only a pimpled-faced teenager in his high school debating class would suggest that free speech means you can say anything, anytime, anywhere. Right.
Yes.
However, one of those limitations I don't necessarily accept, which you have introduced there, is that the law should necessarily be something that should disqualify free speech. In New Zealand...
Sorry, and explain that again. I'm not sure if I understood that.
So you suggested there that, for example, if something is against the law, it's not protected by free speech. I don't necessarily
I'm saying there are certain things you can't say, or if you do say them, you'll infringe the law. Like, yes, the classic one is I can't go to the movies and yell out fire and cause a rush to the exits.
Absolutely. And I think we need to keep our categories clear here, Michael, because there is often quite a lot of obfuscating and blurring of distinct categories here. And so what you're referring to there is criminal nuisance.
Yes.
And yes, while that
incitement
that
to violence.
That illustration comes from a Supreme Court case, and so it's not directly applicable in New Zealand. We have parallel laws that of course are legitimate constraints on free speech.
Yeah.
But legitimate constraints on free speech need to be formed with the view in mind of what the purpose of free speech is. If something is directly opposed to the purpose of free speech, then of course it is not protected by free speech. And so, for example, you just said incitement to violence. The purpose of free speech is that through dialogue and through engagement and through reason, which again are these enlightenment values we've already discussed, through these means we are able to discern a way peacefully forward. Violence is the exact opposite of that. Violence is trying to impose on someone through physical force one perspective over another. And so it is diametrically opposed to free speech. So of course free speech can't protect incitement to violence. It is the antithesis of free speech. In New Zealand, though, and in other Western countries, and in many countries around the world, there are laws that do criminalize legitimate and legal speech. And that is where the Free Speech Union in New Zealand has said, we would take on cases, probably out of principle, that we knew we would probably lose, that a court of law would find outside of the law. But because we believe that free speech, which is primarily a philosophical concept, not a legal one, defends that right. And so, for example, hate speech laws in New Zealand were defeated, but in other parts of the world, they have gone through. Of course, in Scotland recently, they've gone through. The ambiguity associated with this is incredibly dangerous on many levels. To free speech is a fundamental principle within a democratic society, but just to social cohesion and free inquiry and all of the derivative elements as well. I would suggest it's very possible that individuals in Scotland could be arrested and charged under the hate speech laws for speech that speech advocates over there should absolutely stand by. Even though it is possible that a court will find against them, we must stand by this radical idea that has produced the most peaceful, prosperous, and safe societies we've ever known. This radical idea that individuals are not harmed more by speech than by action. And that I think we should put a very high premium on the right for individuals to say provocative, disruptive things, because often that actually is what moves our society forward. Or even if it doesn't move our society forward, it at least provides an outlet that is superior to the form that expression would otherwise take. And so, all that to say, I think absolutely there are limitations to free speech. I think the way we should define those limitations to free speech stems principally in understanding what the purpose of free speech is, first of all, and then going from there to understand what is outside or contradictory to that purpose. And I would suggest even in the West today, and even in New Zealand today, there are some laws that are inconsistent with an antithetical to free speech. If I may, I'm rambling a little bit on this point, but an example of that would be in New Zealand it is illegal to protest, and this is a good segue. I'm setting you up here, Michael.
It's legal to protest.
No.
Sorry.
And this will connect to the rest of our discussion.
I thought I'd misheard you.
It is illegal to protest, outside of hospitals within 300 meters, I believe, right. It's 300 meters, yeah. Against spouting pro-life positions. Yes. And so this is legislation that was put forward relatively recently under the previous government, and it means for pro-lifers who, of course, for decades have held prayer vigils and protested, etc., in a variety of locations, of course, outside hospitals or medical locations that are providing abortions has been a commonplace as well. It is illegal to do that in New Zealand within a certain physical perimeter. I just don't see the justification for that remotely in a free society. Mm. What other ideological position do we exclude?
Well, I think the point is that
I understand the point. But
no, I'm agreeing with you. But if you go down that path, why not this path? You know, there's a myriad of things which we'd rather not have to hear or listen to.
Of course.
And so it is. It's the slippery slope argument, really.
Absolutely, and a sign of maturity and intelligence within the legal system is consistency. And I think we are inviting more and more exceptions in that ultimately stand to potentially undermine the rule itself. And what I wouldn't be surprised to see if we see cases brought forward to extend these limitations on speech rights to other areas off the basis that, well, we accept it in this space. And that's why I insist that free speech advocates need to hold the principle line and say, no, we do not accept that. We do not accept it. While, of course, individuals can be vile and of course it can be incredibly uncomfortable, you know, I'm not arguing with any of that. And of course there can be criminal activity associated with that should not be allowed whatsoever. If individuals want to hold a prayer vigil there, they really should be allowed to.
Yeah. Now, to conclude, I just want your comments on you touched on the incident or the postponement of the freedom of speech discussion at Victoria. I asked two leading student leaders to come on the podcast, and they both declined. What would your comments be about that?
I'm not remotely surprised. What I would suggest, Michael, is I think I've indicated there's a generational difference around perspectives on this issue, and what I think leaders in our institutions need to understand, because I think the dynamic that you're engaging with is actually exactly the same dynamic as what the Vice Chancellor Nick Smith was engaging with when those same student leaders caused such a provocation that the free speech panel was delayed. You're engaging with a group of people and a perspective now that does not view, and again I'm repeating myself a little bit, but it's an important point to labour, that they do not view society as animated by individuals. They view society as animated by groups, and so within that, these groups as a whole form what is their comprehensive perspective, and then that is what defines them as the group, that whatever their group is now thinks this. So in group variation, there's not actually much space for that, and the role of deliberation, the role of dialogue, actually has very little value. And so, the political panel was criticised for not being diverse enough, and ultimately that was the excuse used for delaying this. And now we have this litany of identities that have been forced to be included in order to make sure that it's not undiverse, because I think that's the great cardinal sin of our day.
Well, it's also who defines what diversity actually
exactly.
is. Exactly. Yeah. What does it actually mean?
I don't know how many, we're checking whether there were an equal number of left-handed people as opposed to right-handed people.
What about redheads? Exactly. Are there any redheads on there? And if there wasn't, it's shocking.
And so as the Free Speech Union, we struggled to get those more on the progressive left to engage in our panels and in our events. Mm. And so then people accuse us of being right-wing because there are often more right-wing people engaging with this than lefting. Well, does that define our work, or does that just define the fact that the left, progressive left at the moment in this cultural time is less engaged with that? And should that then be used to then describe the enterprise as a whole? And so I would suggest that these student leaders that you invited on, they would be letting their side down by engaging with you. It's a guilt by association.
Right.
And what value does that actually, have to offer? They're not going to learn anything from you. They're right, obviously. And, well, if you don't agree with them already, you're obviously quite an immoral, hateful bigot. They would probably rather not associate with you and possibly catch that contagion. You know, and so these are the ideas, and they're not new ideas. I'm not going to suggest that they came out of the universities in the 60s or 70s for the first time. They're just reheated ideas that we've had around humanity
They're the human condition.
For centuries, and they're far more the default than the exception. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm fascinated by the idea of what, and you know, again, Michael, I grew up overseas. I didn't grow up in the West, but I look at the strengths and the weaknesses of what the Western world has experienced and what it's produced. And there are absolutely strengths and weaknesses. There are pluses and indisputable minuses and negatives of that as well. But without a doubt, it has produced the highest standard of living, the highest personal freedom, the greatest prosperity, the greatest safety, the greatest quality of life that any human civilization has known across its civilization. Of course, there have been groups and communities that if you were at the very top, you might have experienced a better life than what the average person did in the West. But across our societies, we've experienced such remarkable transformation. What has led to that? I would suggest that there are some, and perhaps these student leaders would be among them, that suggest almost we came across that by accident. I simply refuse to accept that this great exception of human history occurred by accident. And so let's be intellectually humble, and as we consider what caused this ability for the West to expand and to flourish in the way that it did. And I would say the fact that we allowed the provocateurs and the heretics and the unorthodox in our midst to often, not always, there are many exceptions to it, but often the West allowed them to help us move the dialogue and discourse forward, and I think that is a central theme, and I think it's one that we need to remind ourselves of.
Yeah, and I'll just finish with a line from a John Lennon song: "You don't know what you got until you lose it." So on that note, thank you, Jonathan. And I get the feeling that we might have to do this again. That was a lot of fun, and really interesting to hear your thinking on this matter and to hear about your work.
Fantastic. Appreciate it, Michael.